everyone, and welcome to today's webinar titled An Overview of Gene Therapy Manufacturing, Development Through Commercial Production. This webinar is a part of the 4th Annual Bioprocessing Virtual Event. I'm Antonina Salcido of LabRoots, and I will be your moderator for today's event. Today's educational web seminar is presented by LabRoots. Now let's get started. Before we begin, I'd like to remind everyone that this event is interactive. We encourage you to first participate by communicating with other attendees using our new live chat feature during the presentation. You can find the live chat located at the right of your screen. You can also participate by submitting as many questions as you would like during the presentation. To do so, simply type them into the Ask a Question box and click Submit. If you have trouble seeing or hearing the presentation, click on the Help Desk button located at the bottom of your screen within the navigation bar or from the lobby. Finally, as a reminder, this presentation is educational and offers free continuing education credits. Click on the Continuing Education Credits link located in the Abstract window below the Presentation window and follow the process to obtain your credits. I now present today's speakers, Dr. Samir Acharya, Associate Director of Process Development at Andelin Biosciences, and Dr. Kevin G. McGarry, Jr., Manager of Analytical Development, also at Andelin Biosciences. For a complete biography on our speakers, please visit the Biography tab at the left of your screen. Dr. Acharya and Dr. McGarry, you may now begin your presentation.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for that introduction. My name is Kevin McGarry, and with me for this presentation is Samir Acharya. We work for Andelin Biosciences, and we would like to present an overview of gene therapy manufacturing from the development through the commercial production of a gene therapy product. This talk that we are going to present today is for educational purposes, and I would be remiss not to mention our copyright notice that the following presentation is copyrighted by Andelin Biosciences unless otherwise noted, and therefore must not be able to be reproduced without consent from Andelin Biosciences. During today's talk, we would like to discuss what gene therapy is, what the steps involved for getting a gene therapy product from development through the clinic are. And this includes early development, the manufacturing processes, the analytics associated during development, through release, testing, and then the potential challenges associated with the production of a gene therapy product. So first, what is gene therapy? Gene therapy is a field that uses techniques to modify a person's genes to treat or cure diseases. And gene therapies work by a number of different mechanisms. First, you can replace a disease-causing gene with a healthy of a copy gene, a healthy copy of a new gene, or you can inactivate a disease-causing gene that is not functioning properly. Alternatively, you could introduce a new or modified gene into the body to help treat a disease. To do any of these different techniques, there are a number of different products and techniques available. First, you could use direct plasmid DNA. You could use viral vectors, bacterial vectors, human gene editing technology, such as CRISPR, or patient-derived cellular gene therapy products. For the purposes of this talk, we will be focusing on viral vectors specifically. Several viral vectors that are used in the gene therapy field include adenovirus, retroviruses, which include lentiviruses, as well as adeno-associated viruses. Each of these viruses have pros and cons associated with them. Adenoviruses, lentiviruses, and other retroviruses all have the potential for different size payloads, but do present different side effects, including immunogenic response and an inflammatory response. Additionally, as we're aware, all viruses can infect, or viruses can infect individuals, and so specificity is also a a point to be made on these. Further, retroviruses and lentiviruses have the ability to integrate into the genome of the organism it infects. So that specificity component is very, very important. Now, adeno-associated virus is the virus that we will be focusing our talk on mostly today. Adeno-associated virus was discovered in 1965. It was originally thought that it was a contaminant in an adenovirus prep, but it turns out it is a standalone virus. And from 1965 through 1983, the nucleotide sequence was discovered, as well as cloning techniques for AAV2. And once this was all discovered in the 15 to 20 years post its original discovery, the field of gene therapy exploded. Adeno-associated virus is a small, single-stranded DNA virus that can be used as a transduction vector in gene therapy via various delivery mechanism, or as a delivery mechanism. It is a highly versatile technology that can be engineered for specific functionalities in gene therapies. Now that a lot of the biology has been worked out for AAV, it really lends to its versatility as a gene therapy or in gene therapy applications. It is safe and effective in preclinical and clinical settings as far as we can tell to this point. It does not cause any symptomatic infection that we know of, so there is no pathology associated with it. And it can be used in a wide range of clinical applications for multiple diseases due to its unique background and biophysical properties. So diving into the critical aspects of the molecular biology of AAV that is essential for gene therapies, AAV is, as we mentioned, a single-stranded DNA virus that encodes two open reading frames. The first open reading frame is the rep that includes the virus replication factors, as well as the capsid component, which are the viral capsid proteins, VP1, 2, and 3, as well as an assembly factor. The virus itself packages and creates a full intact virus with helper virus factors, which are provided externally. The AAV capsid itself is composed of monomers of VP1, 2, and 3 in a 1:1:10 ratio, which produces an icosahedral-shaped virus with different folds for axis of symmetry. Now, what's really unique or really special about AAV, which makes it very useful in the gene therapy field, is that everything between the inverted terminal repeats, as displayed here, is packaged and for the virus and the DNA. So knowing what we know with molecular biology, you can replace the sequence between the inverted terminal repeats with a promoter and a gene of interest. And then in trans, you can supply the rep and capsid proteins, so via a three plasmid system, which I'll talk about here in a second, to be able to produce intact virus. So as I just said, the intact virus is produced for gene therapy using a three plasmid system in our facility. And the plasmids are the most critical material because they contain the genetic instructions for creating the serotype specific viral vectors, as well as the therapeutic payload. The first plasmid that is used is the AAV vector. So as we showed on our previous slide, and I'll bring this back up here, the promoter and the gene of interest are encoded in this vector. The adenovirus helper helps to put the virus together, so it contains the helper factors that I had mentioned earlier. And then the AAV helper plasmid is what is going to contain your rep and cap sequences to really help define what serotype is going to be used. So at this point, I'm going to turn the slide deck over to Samir to provide some more background.
Yeah, thank you, Kevin. Let's go to the next slide. Okay, so as Kevin mentioned, the essential components of making this gene therapy vector are in the three different plasmids: the plasmids containing the transgene of interest, the AD helper, which has the helper virus factors necessary for packaging it, and the AAV helper, which essentially decides what serotype will be used for gene therapy. The next slide shows that the number of serotypes that are currently being used, and this is just a small representative of the serotypes that are commonly used now. This lists around 7 or 8, but if you look at the clinical trials, we have more than 15 serotypes currently available. And there is a lot of work which is currently being done to even make better serotypes. The challenges in the field are, firstly, why do we make so many serotypes? The challenges are because we want to achieve the specificity and tropism that is required in order to prevent any side effects or future side effects. So if you want a serotype to be targeting a tissue like lung, you want it only to go to the lung and minimize any kind of targeting to any other cell type. So as more and more capsids become available, that becomes another tool to use to make an effective gene therapy vector. So what we do in our company, and I will go through that briefly into the next few slides. And let's go to the next slide. So this kind of encapsulates in a big picture what are the required work that needs to be done before we are able to manufacture the gene therapy vector in large amounts. And this is pretty much belongs to 3 or 4 different departments in our company. The first, we start with the plasmid. Again, the goal that we look forward is how to make an effective gene therapy vector which has the minimum side effect and which can be accepted as per the FDA guidelines to be introduced into a patient. So when we start about making these AAV vectors, we start with the plasmid. And the plasmid involves the construction of the plasmid. It can be a construction of the vector plasmid, which has the gene of interest, the AAV helper plasmid for the serotype, and the AD helper plasmid. And there's a lot of work which goes on behind the scenes for that. This work is done mainly in the discovery stage, which is primarily done with clients. And then we assist in that process for the cloning or engineering of that vector. So the genome design, as Kevin mentioned, carries a gene expression cassette. It includes a promoter, it has a transgene of interest, it has other regulatory elements that ensure appropriate transcription termination and other regulatory factors which we make sure that we have a proper gene expression going on without any side effects due to the elements that are present there. For example, one of the things that is implicit in gene therapy is that when we introduce a gene into a patient, it should achieve the necessary expression level. So in design, as everyone knows, we have to then design appropriate promoters to achieve that level. The next is we have to consider where is this gene going to be delivered to. So is that promoter, let's say if it's going to a lung cell or a liver cell and so on and so forth, we want to make sure that the promoters are appropriate for that expression. There's a lot of background work which goes on, not just in the individual laboratories, but also in the companies, where we try to make sure that before we manufacture the vector, we have all the elements covered. All the regulatory elements should be in accordance with whether cells are dividing or non-dividing, because AAV has a unique property that it can go into both dividing cells as well as non-dividing cells. And that's a huge advantage that we have. So prior knowledge of that helps us design appropriate promoters and regulatory elements. From the industry standpoint, it is also critical to assess whether any of these DNA elements that we are putting in while designing the vector or the serotype plasmid is that whether any of these DNA elements have a tumorigenic potential or not. And if so, they need to be removed in accordance with the safety guidelines provided by the FDA. The other points in consideration for the plasmid design include whether the expression will lead to toxicity or whether it will trigger any unwanted immune response. And that kind of knowledge is, that's where some of the challenges are. That goes hand in hand with what's going on in the laboratories, animal studies, and as the knowledge comes forth, we can keep on improving the design. So once the design is completed, the plasmid construction is completed, we then have to worry about plasmid production and purification. And that's where every gene has to be evaluated. Some genes by nature are not expressed in a large amount. Some plasmids are not expressed in large amounts. So we have to devise strategies. That's what we do in the industry setting, in the development side of things. We make sure that we have the appropriate cells, bacterial cells, to produce that plasmid in larger amounts, and then we purify that. So in the laboratory, it might seem it might seem trivial to, say, produce 1 milligram of plasmid, but we are talking about gram quantities of plasmid in a very pure. The purity is one of the most important things, and that will come to it later on, because much of what we do later on depends on the purity of the plasmid. So the whole plasmid division takes care of those issues: high expression of plasmids, high amount of plasmid, and purity to the extent that is accepted. The current guidelines for many companies for purity is that it should be at least 80% supercoiled in nature. But from experience, we can say the better the superhelicity of the plasmid, the better we'll be in the downstream events. Remember, this is a transfection event. We have to use this plasmid to transfect cells. And there are many considerations of how a transfection will take place. And so the purity is very important. So once that is done, then the plasmid comes to our hands to see how well we can develop the process of making the AAV vector. And that's where the next set of points are. What we consider is, we start with what is the dose of AAV that is required. It depends on the delivery type. Is it a targeted delivery to a specific organ or tissue, or is it a systemic delivery? And based on that, if you look at clinical trials, and this is where the challenges are, how much of vector is needed for either of these deliveries. So on average, if you look at clinical trials, the range is between 10 to the power of 9 to 10 to the power of 15 vector genomes per adult dose. And that is calculated based on a lot of studies, clinical, preclinical studies. And that's for a targeted injection. For a systemic delivery, this amount of dose goes up. An average is anywhere between 10 to the power of 13 to the 10 to the power of 15 vector genomes per dose per adult. So we have to consider that while we're designing a strategy for production of this vector. Again, to achieve that, the next point is what cells and what platform to use. There are a variety of cells that are used, and that comes into play. The most commonly used cells from the human cell point is a human embryonic kidney cell. But there are other cells, like insect cells, which are also being used to make AAV vectors. And then this comes to platform. We decide whether it's going to be an adherent platform. So we use cells which are growing in an adherent manner, or a suspension platform, which has its own advantages and uniqueness about it. So once that decision is taken place, then we have to evaluate strategies of making that amount of vector. And the different aspects of that is listed in this slide. And that will be, we develop strategies to maximize viral titers, that is upstream development. We develop strategies to purify that vector, that comes under downstream development. And while this is going on, hand in hand, we are considering what is the quality of the product when we are using these strategies, and what is the formulation strategy. By formulation strategy, we have to consider what are the different kinds of formulation buffers which we can put this virus in. After all, in the end, we will have to have a formulation which is in accordance with the FDA guidelines, which will be applicable to for injection into a human. So all those all these steps require in-process characterization. Once we have a small scale strategy developed for production of this virus in the purity that we want and the quality that we want, we then have to go to scaling up, because that's where it's at. Manufacturing is done at very large scales in a bioreactor format. So once we do a scale up, we have to then define in that process of a scale up, what are the critical process parameters, what are the ranges, and I'll go into that in the next few slides, and what are the critical quality attributes in that process. So we need to determine what these points are. Our goal is to have as much control over the process so that we have complete knowledge of what's going on and what can be the repercussions of if something goes wrong. So as I mentioned, hand in hand with determining the quality are the assays that are involved in determining what we define as a quality. And that comes under the category of release assays. And Kevin will go through that in the next, eventually. Once all this is done, we do a tech transfer. Tech transfer is a process where we transfer our process to the manufacturing division. That is the final step in development. After that, we are kind of handing the keys for large-scale production. An assumption is that by the time we reach this stage, we have complete knowledge or as best knowledge as possible till date in order to make that vector. After that, it's just production and then going on to clinical. So in this slide, I'm just going to cover the upstream and downstream development that is needed prior to us doing a transfer of a process to a manufacturing division. What we know already before we start this is what is the dose needed for the virus, what are the cells we choose, and then now we have to devise a strategy how we can maximize the titer and how we can purify. So what is listed here is a broad view of strategies that we cover. And these are just examples, and I'll explain that. So in order to develop an optimized platform for production and purification, there are a lot of studies that need to be performed. For upstream production, upstream development, the strategies are, we start with a goal. Our goal is, of course, to maximize the titers. So some of the factors that we have to cover are, what are the cellular factors that are required for maximizing production? Does DNA play a role? Are the media playing a role? Since this is a transfection-based process, what are the different transfection reagents that we can play a role in? And for example, when do we harvest? So I'll just give you a few examples for each of these factors. So remember, the overall goal is to have identify factors that will be optimized to maximize the production. If our goal is to maximize production, we can go through this process by one factor at a time, which is a very prolonged process. But what we do is use a design of experiments approach, which is now pretty widely accepted in a lot of companies and also laboratories, in order to evaluate the effect of multiple factors at a time. The advantage of that is also with that approach, we also understand how different factors are interacting with each other. If you do one factor at a time, we will not get that answer, or we will get that answer after much longer experimentation than now. Okay. Clearly, there is some computational analysis which is associated with that, but that comes hand in hand when you devise a strategy. So I said, let's go to the cell factors. What cell factors can we consider? The cell factors include what cell density to use. That again depends on the properties of cells that we're using. An insect cell may be different from a human cell. What cell stage should we use? Does that play a role in improving viral titers? What cell viability is important? So all these factors are considered. So we devise certain ranges that we cover in that and design the experiment that way. From the DNA factors, it includes concentrations of plasmids. We have a three plasmid system. What concentration to use? What ratios of each plasmid to use? What are the total DNA amounts that we are going to use? All that come into the design. The media factors include media types. There are a variety of medias, and I'll come briefly touch upon that later on. What are the different properties of these medias? As much as we can know, these media that we buy are proprietary. So we try to work with companies to get as much information that we will provide to the FDA in order to have as much control over the media or not. Are there any media additives that need to be added? So all that goes into this factor. And is that, does that play a role in the overall production? Of course, I mentioned transfection reagents. There are a variety of transfection reagents based on lipids, based on small compounds, and you name it. So we have to choose which transfection reagent we should work with. What is the concentration of that transfection reagent? Does that concentration depend on the amount of DNA we use and or amount of cell we use? So transfection reagent per DNA, transfection reagent amounts per cell, and those are the transfection reagent factors we include in the experimentation strategy. Another point you mentioned is, when do we harvest the cells? And these are just a few of the factors. And it may seem daunting, but much of this is governed by the knowledge that we already have from the biology of these cells. We're not starting from scratch. We are starting from a body of knowledge which is developed in a lot of laboratories in the world. And we can, as we go forward, we can add some factors, physical factors. Is temperature important? Is pH important? So on and so forth. The outcome of that is, once we do this experiment, we get an idea of what factor is involved and how does it affect the response. In this case, if you look at the right side of the a brief model is given. This is a response model which comes up, and it just shows factor one in one axis, factor two in another axis, and the z-axis is titer. So if our goal is to see what is the variations of factor one and factor two to maximize titer, we look at the red region. And this is the beginning of a model. So we want to be as much into the red region. So that gives us a boundary of what factor one properties we should work with, what factor two properties we work with. In this model, it says that we should have low level of factor two, that's factor one, and a medium range of factor two to achieve maximum viral titers. So a series of experiments like this, then in a small scale, very small scale, will let us identify optimized factors to work with. Once we have that, we start to the next stage. We have optimized a set of factors which lead to increased viral production. Now, can we use those factors to increase and see if we can purify those proteins, those viruses? So again, we can do a similar set of downstream development. What are the clarifications that we use? Remember, we are not going to be using in the manufacturing scale. We'll be using hundreds of liters of scale. We cannot use centrifugation as a strategy of removing cellular debris. So we use filters, clarification filters. So what kind of filters to use? Do they play a role in the viral quality and the viral production? There is ultrafiltration and dye filtration factors that come in hand, how we concentrate the virus before we go to the chromatography step. It can be affinity, it can be ion exchange, and you name it. So we cover all those. And finally, but not the least, are the formulation buffer in which we want to concentrate the virus in. So all the similar strategy will tell us whether we have an optimized condition that will lead to a optimized purification strategy as well. As we understand the biology, we can either narrow these factors or we can increase the factors. So in the next slide, yes. So as we said, the next step is the quality of the product, and that is going hand in hand. We have, in the process development, we have to have in-process characterization at each stage. We track, not only do we track the virus, we also track where the impurities are being removed. And that is very important for an FDA point of view, for a phase 3 point of view, so we have more control. There are many functional assays we need to be developing. If certain conditions are leading to aggregation, we need to know that. And what if certain conditions lead to a better full capsid than empty, then we need to know that. So all this is in line with our analytical capabilities that we have to assess at each stage. Once we have that, then we go to scale. That's where we're going. When we go to flask to bioreactor scale, there are some factors which are scale dependent. So if you go to, for example, if you go to bioreactor, factors like impeller speed, gas flows within the bioreactor, whether it's a resin-backed bioreactor or a suspension bioreactor, that comes to play. And we optimize that as we go along. Once we have that process developed, we need to see if the scales, if our conditions that we optimize are scalable. And that is shown in the below, the figure below is a representative figure that when we go from small scale to big scale, we are having a scalable platform. Once this is done, and on the right side is just a representative SCS gel, but we have other methods of estimating purity, which is more quantifiable and more sensitive. Then we have a process. This is ready for the technology transfer. That's in the next slide. And tech transfer is a huge landmark for any company. So this is the step which tells us go to manufacturing, whether it's a research grade manufacturing, preclinical, or clinical manufacturing. And associated with this tech transfer is a huge amount of documentation which has to go. Essentially, we are giving the keys for production. Everything, all the study reports, all the protocols, all the SOPs, master batch records, what are the success criteria for each stage of production and detailed testing. Once this goes to tech transfer, the manufacturing division essentially follows it and produces it. The development side then assesses whether that production was successful or not based on the success criteria laid out in the document and the testing which is necessary for that. So this is the step that we do, and I will pass it over to Kevin here, because the next important stage is the release assays, which go hand in hand with tech transfer and everything else. Kevin, thank you.
All right, thank you, Samir. As Samir mentioned, the next steps are our release assays. And many of the physical and functional characterization steps that were performed as part of the in-process testing are also used by our quality control teams, developed by our analytical development teams, for release of a product. As Samir had mentioned as well, the FDA has guidelines associated with various, with the biological therapeutics, and the quality of the product is of utmost importance. We need to understand what the potency is, what the titer is, what the infectivity of the virus is. Are there any residual host cell impurities remaining in the end product? We have to obviously ensure sterility. You do not want to induce any sort of immunogenic properties from your therapeutic if it can be avoided, especially due to the product itself not being sterile. And then the empty and full, as we had mentioned earlier as well, the virus will package everything that is present between the inverted terminal repeats, but every once in a while the virus does not efficiently package everything. So we need to know whether or not the capsids are full or empty. So all of these are evaluated as part of quality control. The in-process testing is typically performed either by quality control or the analytical development teams. But from a quality standpoint, all of these do need to be evaluated on the end product, and for late stage, for late phase testing, as well as for commercial release, every one of these tests must be product specific, because as Samir also mentioned, the formulation buffer as well as each of these processes must be very well characterized. So on a product by product specific basis, the FDA needs to know that there aren't any residual host cell impurities, that the matrices that these products are produced in are not impacting the testing that is performed. So on our next slide here, we outline the overall manufacturing process. We segregate between the upstream and the downstream processes. So on the very early on, you have your good manufacturing practices, but that's what GMP is. You have your raw materials. You have your plasmids that are going to be used, your media, and the HEC, and in this case for an adherent cell platform, we're talking our HEC293 cells. But in this case, dependent upon the virus being used or the production method being used, the cell type might vary. For the production stage, we have our plasma DNA that's going to be used in the transfection, the media harvest, and then the upstream purification processes that are associated. Following this, we go to production of the fill finish, and this includes the downstream purification and really the finishing and packaging of the end product. And at this point, quality control is being looped back into the whole process. It's not part of the upstream process, it's now part of the release. And all of the tests that were recently outlined are being characterized, the drug substance itself is being characterized, the release testing is being performed, and then ultimately, stability is being evaluated. Long-term stability is essential when the drug is in the clinic. So these will be evaluated typically on a month-by-month basis, then to 6 months and years down the line. And then also environmental monitoring is included in this to ensure sterility. Some various quality control and analytical development assays that need to be considered are in-process testing, as we had mentioned earlier, for the production, the drug substance testing, as we just mentioned, the product release, product stability, the toxicology studies need to be produced or need to be verified. If there's device testing that needs to be performed, that's also included, as well as that environmental monitoring that we just mentioned. Here, I'm not going to read through all of these, but these are any number of assays that are performed to evaluate from the titer that will be delivered all the way through the impurities of the associated host cell and production process. And then several studies have highlighted the biological relevance of the modifications for transduction efficiency and tropism, but also for stability. So there are certain specialized assays that are now becoming critical and are in development that measure the changes in post-translational modifications, including glycosylations and phosphorylations. So these are all very, very important for the delivery of gene therapies, specifically in this case, in biologics in general. In this case, we hope we have provided a pretty high level overview from concept of a gene therapy to commercialization using a CDMO in our case, a contract development manufacturing organization. It will ultimately start with the plasmids, move on through development, manufacturing, finally to fill finish. But there are a lot of steps and a lot of integration there along the way that a researcher should consider very, very early on, because again, when you're trying to take the disease that you're working on and trying to develop a therapeutic for it, even if something looks promising, there are a lot of different steps and a lot of processes along the way that need to be considered, which takes us back to really why all of us are working in this field to begin with. And it's a patient first mentality. It's very personalized. If someone is in need of gene therapy, it is obviously a very personal disease. And that is why I would like to highlight the story behind who Andelyn is. And I had mentioned earlier that this was all for educational purposes, but again, I just really need to emphasize here that we are all working in this field for the patients. So Andelyn is named in honor of two gene therapy patients who participated in a very pivotal phase one clinical trial at Nationwide Children's Hospital. Andrew was 8 years old and he received the first U.S. investigational gene therapy for DMD in 2006. And Evelyn was 8 weeks old, who received an experimental gene therapy for SMA in 2015. So thinking back on it, 2006 and 2015 aren't that long ago. The very first gene therapies approved were in 2012, and that was in Europe. And then in the United States, the first approved gene therapy was in 2017. So Andrew and Evelyn is where Andelyn came from. But you can see these were phase one or very early phase clinical trials for very rare diseases. Evelyn, I think at time of diagnosis, was not expected to live beyond 2 years old. And she is still alive to this day. She visited our facility just, it was last summer. So things are going very well for these two children. And again, patient first is really the reason that all of us are in the gene therapy field. And then we would like to open it up to questions. Samira and I apologize that we will not be able to be there when this presentation is aired. But we would encourage you to reach out to us at our email addresses here, and we would be happy to take any questions that you might have. And we look forward to hearing from you. And hopefully this is informational. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Acharya and Dr. McGarry, for your time today and your important research. Before we go, I'd like to thank the audience for joining us today. Questions submitted today and during the on-demand period will be addressed by the speakers via the contact information you provided at the time of registration. This webcast can be viewed on demand for 2 years until April 6, 2024. LabRoots will alert you via email when it's available for replay. We encourage you to share that email with your colleagues who may have missed today's live event. Until next time, goodbye.